casting techniques. This is the topic that we are going to discuss today. So, for casting techniques, this section is divided into various subsections. There are also various topics that are included in the forecasting techniques are discussed in here. So, this diagram, as you can see, under forecasting diagram, we have techniques. We have linear regression analysis. In this linear regression analysis, we have simple linear regression and multiple linear regression. Another topic is time series analysis, another learning curve analysis, and the last one is expected values. These are the various methods or various techniques that we are going to discuss under the forecasting technique session of planning, budgeting, and forecasting. Right. So let's get into one by one. So what is forecasting? Before going into the various methods of forecasting techniques, what is forecasting? Forecasting means we used to make predictions about the future based on the past and present data. So, based on the past and present data, we used to make certain predictions, which is certain estimations or forecast for the future period. That process is what is called forecasting. So, it's based on the as I said, it is based on the past and the present data. So we used to make prediction based on the past and present data. By analyzing the past and present data, we used to make certain predictions for the future. So this forecasting techniques is very important in the planning process, in the budgeting process, because the budget is prepared for a future period, right? The period with which is not the current period, but the future period. So while we make budget for the future period, the budget is mainly based on estimations and forecasting. Actually, the body of the budget, it is the budget as the estimation of revenues and expenses for the future period. So, in order to estimate revenues and expenses of the future period, we need to forecast certain variables, certain factors that affect the revenues and expenses. So, then only we could make accurate estimates of revenues and expenses for the future period. Then only we could make a good budget. So often we use forecasting and prediction simultaneously, but it's similar, but a prediction is more of a general term. But forecasting is not a general term, it's a narrow term. Prediction, as you use in this common scenarios, use in the day-to-day life, it's a general term, but forecasting is a little bit different. So forecasting may be a result for estimates of values at certain specific future times. While prediction is used for more general estimates, such as the number of times it will rain, how number of the days in a year that it will get rain. These are all the general ways in which prediction is used. But forecasting is for a specific future date, for a specific, there will be a time period, that is specific time period mentioned in the forecasting. So only for that time period is forecasted. Like that is more of a general term, it's more of a commonly used term. So the first method of the forecasting technique that we are going to discuss today is linear regression. So what is regression? In the statistical modeling, the statistic techniques we use to discuss the word regression. Regression is analysis a set of statistical procedures for estimating the relationship between two variables. How there will be a dependent variable and there will be one or more independent variable. So, based on this independent variable, we need to make a forecast for the dependent variable. Say we have two variables, X and Y. No, X will be the independent variable, Y will be the dependent variable. So, that is Y is dependent on X. Let's say, for example, if X is the advertisement and Y variable represents the sales values. So, the sales value is always dependent upon the amount of advertisement, the surface of advertisement that we make. So if X is the independent variable and Y is the dependent variable, so you need to make a forecast for Y based on this independent variable. There may be one or more independent variables. Based on this independent variable, we used to make a forecast for the dependent variable. This is what is called regression. So linear regression means a simple linear regression, or it may be multiple linear regression. In a simple linear regression, there may be only one independent variable and a dependent variable. So in simple linear regression, we used to make forecast for this dependent variable based on one independent variable. And here you can see the slide, you can see the equation for the simple linear regression line, that is equal to y is equal to a plus bx. Here y is the dependent variable and x is the independent variable. So we used to make prediction for this independent variable y based on the independent variable, that is x. So here A, as you can see, is the y-intercept, because y, what is y-intercept? It is the point where the graph, where it touches, where it crosses the y-axis. It is what is called y-intercept, or in simple terms, we used to say when x is equal to 0, y is equal to what? This is what is the y-intercept. Here A represents the y-intercept, or which is also called the constant coefficient. And B represents the slope of the line. That means the amount by which the y value of the regression line changes when the value changes by 1 unit. So when the x changes by a certain unit, how much of the change will be represented in the y-axis? This is what is called slope of the regression line. And B in this equation is the slope of the regression line. It is also called variable coefficient. And x is the independent variable. The independent variable. So, as you can see, y is equal to a plus bx. Y is the independent variable. A is the constant coefficient or y-intercept. B is the variable coefficient, or it is also called the slope of the regression line. And we have x. X is the independent variable. By using x as the independent variable, we are going to predict the dependent variable y. This is what is a simple linear regression line. A single independent variable is used to predict dependent variable. So are you clear? Okay then. So here we have an example. This is about an ice cream business. We are trying to figure out what causes sales. What is the main causing factor behind the sales? And we have measured two independent variables. One is temperature, and the one is the number of people wearing shorts we observe walking down the streets in 10 minutes. So our business is mainly selling of ice creams, and we are going to analyze what drives sales and what causes sales. And for that sake, we have measured two independent variables. One is temperature, and the other is the number of people wearing shorts while we observe in the street in 10 minutes. Here, our dependent variable is here. Y is our independent variable. What is y? Y is the sales. Sales is dependent upon the two independent variables, that is temperature and the number of people wearing shorts, that number of people. So X represents the independent variable, that is what temperature and the number of people wearing shorts. So this is the example for a multiple linear regression. So as I said earlier, for the simple linear regression, we have example for, let's take example for advertisement and sales. Advertisement will be the independent variable and sales will be the dependent variable. We estimate that based on how much of the sale is affected, how much the sale is affected by the advertisement. Sales will be the dependent variable. Sales is dependent upon the advertisement that we provide, the amounts per one advertisement, the success of the advertisement. All these factors going to affect the sales volume that we are going to make this year. So in this example, this is always only one independent variable, that is advertisement, and one dependent variable, that is sales. But in this example of ice cream business that we are going to figure out what drives sales, here we have two independent variables. One is temperature and the other is the number of people wearing shorts. And why that dependent variable is the sales. So this is an example for multiple linear regression analysis. In multiple linear regression analysis, from the example itself, it is very clear that we are going to explain the relationship between two dependent variables based on two or more. We are going to explain the relationship between one dependent variable and one or more independent variable. So commonly, usually the sales may be affected not by the advertisement itself. There may be other factors that are going to affect the sales. which may include advertising expenditure, as I said earlier, the size of the sales staff, the sales force, the competition provided in the industry, the economic factors, or any other number of, there may be many number of numerous circumstances that are going to impact our sales, the reputation of the company, or the demand, or the taste and preferences of the customer. There are many factors that are going to affect the sales. There will be two or more independent variables that are going to affect the sales. So I think simply in the regression equation, we are only going to study one independent variable and dependent variable. But in multiple linear regression analysis, we are going to study the effect on dependent variable or by two or more or one or more independent variables. So the regression of the multiple linear regression line will be y is equal to a plus b1 x1 plus b2 x2 plus b3 x3 plus sutra plus bn xz. There will be numerous factors that are going to affect the sales. A will be the coefficient constant, which will be okay, but x1, x2, x3, and xn that are going to be the independent variable, and b1, b2, b3, bn will be the corresponding variable coefficients of those independent variables. So this is an example for simple linear regression. As you can see here, we just for a year, the Jim Jones Corporation, the budgeted data, annual sales and marketing budget of Jim Jones Corporation is given for the four quarters of a year, quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four, and marketing cost in thousands is provided, 60,000, 60, 55, 45, and 70, and sales in thousands are also provided. The data is provided here. The sales represents the dependent variable and marketing cost or advertisement. Let us take it simply. Marketing cost will be the independent variable. We are setting a relationship between the marketing cost and sales. This is an example for simple linear regression equation, simple linear regression model. Okay, this all will be a regression, simple linear regression and multiple linear regression. We are going to estimate the dependent variable based on the independent variable. This, the most commonly used equation is for simple linear regression is y is equal to a plus bx. This is what is mainly asked for the exam. In the exam scenario, we have the negative one, certain variables. We need to just put the variables in the right position in this equation and we need to find what is being asked. So the y will be given, we need to find a, we need to find b, or we need to find x. Based upon the situations, the questions may the questions are different, and we just need to put the right things in the right place, and we need to find what is required. Are you clear? Are you clear? Okay. B stands for the variable coefficient. It is also called the slope of the regression line. Because let's assume that y is equal to a plus bx. Here, x will be the independent variable. Let's say it is the advertisement and marketing cost. And y is the independent variable sales. And A will be the constant coefficient. So, we need to find A is equal to Y is equal to A plus BX. So our let's take an example. Our marketing cost or advertising cost comprises of both fixed element and variable element. As you know, the variable element will change with the changes in the number of sales or level of activity. So, X represents the independent variable advertisement, and B as the variable coefficient. We just want to put A will be the constant amount or constant coefficient, that will be constant amount divided by 16. We just need to put A, and B will be the variable coefficient, and X will be the number of sales or number of units sold, like that. So we could find that relation, we could find just substitute all the values in this equation, and we could find the answer for Y. So B is what is called the variable coefficient, or it is also called the slope of the regression line. The slope means with the change in X variable, how much of the change is affected in the Y variable. So that is what is called the slope of the regression line. I clear now? And the equation 1 is equal to a plus bx. X is the independent variable. This independent variable can also be called explanatory variable, and y is the dependent variable. B is the slope of the regression line or variable coefficient. A represents the constant coefficient. So are you clear with the regression equation? So next we are going to discuss the merits and demerits of regression analysis. So the merits of regression analysis is that it helps in forecasting and finding the relationship between variables. So as a regression is what? Regression is the method of method used to find or forecast a relationship, a degree of relationship between two variables. There may be in one dependent variable or there may be one or more independent variable. So we are going to forecast or we are going to find the degree of relationship between two variables through the use of regression analysis. So it helps in forecasting. Why we find the relationship between two or more variables, which helps in forecasting other variable based on this independent variable. So it helps in forecasting. And the next merit is it helps small businesses to understand variables that can impact its success. So it's very helpful for a small business. So they can find out that what are all the variables that are going to impact their successful operations. So identifying the factors that contribute to the success of their businesses, they could make use of those factors and they could make better use of those factors and take advantage of those opportunities. So it's very helpful for the small businesses. So this is the other merit. This regression analysis is an important tool for budgeting accounting too, because in budgeting we are creating a budget, we are estimating the revenues and expenses for a future period. So this regression is a forecasting technique. Forecast is being used in the process of budgeting. So regression is very helpful for budgeting and cost accounting too. And the demerits and disadvantages of regression analysis is that. So there are certain assumptions on which a regression analysis is built upon. So one of the main assumptions is that the cause and effect relationship between the variables that you are going to forecast, the variables that are under consideration, remains constant. So which does not always be true. So the cause and effect relationship between, we assume that there is a constant cause and effect relationship between the variables under consideration, which may not be true in all circumstances. So in certain cases, it may lead to misleading results. And the other demerit is that in multiple linear regression, a single linear regression or multiple linear regression analysis, there are more than one independent variables that are used to predict dependent variable. So the calculations and the analysis may be lengthy and complicated procedure. This is one of the demerits of regression analysis. So regression analysis is used for the quantitative method. It's a quantitative analysis. We are going to quantitatively measure the impact of independent variable on the dependent variable. But it cannot be used in qualitative aspects like honesty, crime, quality, etc. On such cases, we are going to use this regression analysis because it is a quantitative measure, it is not a qualitative measure. So these are the main merits and demerits of regression analysis. Let's move forward. Yeah, the other forecasting techniques that after the single linear regression is time series analysis. As the name itself suggests, it's a series based on time. In this time series analysis, the main factor that is causing this change is the passage of time. And this time series is the forecasting method that is used to predict future values based on observed past values. Based on certain past values, certain values for the past years or past period of time, we are going to forecast for the future period. So the main causal factor in the time series analysis is the passage of time. So it reflects or shows the historical activity of one variable over a previously observed past time period. So In time series analysis, we will be discussing the relationship between sales or profit. Let's take the examples of sales and profit. Sales is one of the important factors that is one causing, that is determining factor of profit. So here we are going to analyze the trends in sales and profits for the past 10 years. Let's say the time series, we are predicting the data based upon the time period for the passage time for the previously observed period. So let's take for a 10-year period, we are going to estimate the relationship between sale and profit. We are given the sales for the 10 years, and we are given the sale and profit data for the 10 years, and we are going to estimate what will be the profit for the 11th year and sales for the 11th year. So there will be a trend. We are going to analyze the trend for a particular period of time. Based upon the trend, we are going to predict for the next period. This time series analysis of methods of forecasting, we are only using the historical values. We are going to assume a pattern for this pattern for the period, and based upon this factor based upon the trend, we are going to predict the value for the next period. So this is what time series analysis. So the most frequently used time series analysis pattern is the trend pattern, in which we could observe after putting all the data for the particular period of time in an order, we could observe certain trend, which may be increasing trend or decreasing trend, which may be fluctuating trend, it may be seasonal trend, or which may be an irregular trend, or whatever it may be. There will be a trend pattern. Based upon this trend pattern, we are going to predict the value for the next period. Let's take the example of sales itself. We record the sales data for the past 10 years for a company, and the sales may be fluctuating, but we could observe that even though the sales are fluctuating from year to year, but it is showing an upward trend. The trend, when we project the sales data in a graph and we represent it using a trend line, it shows that the sales, even though it is fluctuating, the trend is that it is rising. The sales are moving upwards. So it is one of the using this trend pattern, we could estimate the trend for the 11th year based upon this pattern. So we could see an example here. You please look at the diagram. We have years 1 to 10, 1 to 11 years, and we are provided with the sales data for these years. We could see the sales data as represented using this green line, and the regression line with forecast is fitted into this graph, and this dotted line is representing the regression line with the forecast, and the green line is the sales data, sales for this 10 years, and we could see that even though the sales are fluctuating from year to year, but it is showing a rising trend. When we fit the regression line into this graph, we could see that sales are rising. There will be an upward linear trend showing here. Sorry. So here it is showing an upward trend. It can also be a downward trend or non-linear trend, or maybe there. Or there will be no trend at all. Based upon the nature of the data, we could assume any kind of trend. Here, the points are not the sales data for this. Here, the sales values for this periods of time are not scattered very far. It's always correlated. It is always just adjacent to each other. And while we fit a regression line, it is observed that it is showing an upward trend. When these points in this graph are scattered all around, it shows there is no trend at all. Or if this point is showing that it is rising from up to it is going down, we could observe a downward sloping trend. Okay, after completing the linear regression, after complete time series analysis, the next forecasting technique that we are going to discuss is the learning curve analysis. So the learning curve, as the name of the test learning curve, it refers to that a curve which represents learning. The main concept behind this learning curve is that the efficiency increases as the amount of experience that a person gets. As the experience increases, efficiency also increases. Experience and efficiency is shown in this learning curve. It's the main concept behind this learning curve. It's what is called when the person are put to a situation, when the person are gaining more and more experience in his working place, he is going to be more efficient. His efficiency is going to increase day by day as the experience in a given task is going to increase. Let's take the example of a person who's provided with a work. The work may be of repetitive work. It is a labor work. For the first time he's doing, he may require for the first unit, he is requiring 10 minutes. And while he's producing more and more units, at the time required to produce each unit will decrease as he's gaining experience. At the same time, his efficiency is also increasing. His speed, his capability is also increasing. So for the first unit, he may be using 10 minutes. And for the second unit, he may not be using this 10 minute. In total, he may be using 18 minutes. That is, for one unit, he may be using 9 minutes only. So, as the number of units he is producing, as the experience he is gaining, his efficiency also increases, and the time required to produce each unit will be also decreasing. This is what is called learning curve, as it suggests that when a person who has given a task, the experience in that task increases, his efficiency is also increasing, thereby the time and cost required for performing that task is going to increase as he is gaining experience and efficiency is also increasing. So this is the main concept behind the learning curve analysis. This is the main part that is tested in our CMA exam. It's very important part as well. So here we have an example on a personal level. Here we have given the example of a college student Terry. He is very excited, this student Terry. He is very excited to go for spring break. So he and some of his friends decided that they are going to camp, and he and his friends went and purchased a brand new tent. So when arriving at the first campsite, so Terry took out the instructions that is given by maybe the camp guide or any other persons who are engaged. And he laid out all the materials and poles that are used to build a tent. And he took 40 minutes to construct his first tent. And the next morning, he packed up all his gear, his bag, he packed up all his bag, and he hiked to the mountains to the next campsite. And at the second time, he only took 30 minutes to construct his site because he had an experience of constructing this tent before. For the first time, he took 40 minutes, and he got an experience in constructing that. He as well. Well-versed in how materials and poles are to be placed in order to build a tent. For the second time after building a tent, he only required 30 minutes. And by the end of the trip, sorry, by the end of the trip, he built another tent, it took only 23 minutes. So this is a personal experience with a learning curve. When you do a job repeatedly, when you are doing a job more and more times, the time taken to complete the job is going to decrease because your expertise or your experience in that job is going to increase, by which your efficiency will be increasing, and the time and the cost that you require to do that job or to produce that product is going to decrease with the increase in your efficiency. This is the personal example for a learning curve. From a day-to-day example itself, we could arrive at more and more examples in our day-to-day life itself. So there are two learning curve models that are commonly used. The one is the cumulative average time learning model, and the second one is the incremental unit time learning model. So the first thing, the cumulative average time learning model is based upon this assumption that when the number of units, the cumulative quantity of units, the number of units, cumulative number of units that we produce doubles. When the number of units that we produce doubles, the cumulative average time required to produce per unit is going to decline at a constant rate. So the cumulative average time learning model, it can be used to estimate the average time that is required to produce the number of produce the number of products under production. So this once more, in cumulative average time gradient model, it is based on assumption that the cumulative average time per unit required to produce the number of units, when this number of units produced doubles, will be declining at a constant rate, and it can be used to estimate the average time required per unit for producing the product. And the other method that is used is incremental unit time learning model. In this incremental unit time learning model, the main assumption is that the incremental or additional amount of time that is required to produce the last unit declines at a constant rate. Each time the cumulative number of units produced doubles. Each time the number of units produced doubles, the incremental amount of time, the extra amount of time that is required to produce the last unit will be declining at a constant rate. But in the cumulative average time learning model, when the cumulative number of units produced doubles, the cumulative average time required to produce one unit will be declining at a constant rate. Whereas in the incremental unit time learning model, when the cumulative number of units produced doubles, the incremental amount of time required to produce the last unit will be declining at a constant rate. So, by using the incremental unit time learning model, we could estimate the time required to produce the last unit. Hello. But in cumulative average time learning model, we could estimate the time required to produce all of the units. It's average time required to produce all of the units. In our CME exam point of view, we are only going to apply the cumulative average time learning model. There is an application for the incremental unit time learning model. We are going to discuss the cumulative average time learning model in detail. So we have an example. Here we have an example. So here it is, the example is for a car manufacturing firm. A plant that manufactures car is subject to the result 80% learning curve. Let's say the learning curve is represented in the percentage terms. That is from 50 to 100%. The learning curve is represented in the percentage term. That is 80% learning, 90% learning, 60% learning. 50% learning, like that, the learning curve that is represented in a percentage basis. So, for a plant that manufactures cars that is subject to 80% learning curve, so in order to produce the first car, 10 hours are required. As you can see in the question, for producing the first model car, first car, 10 hours are required. According to the cumulative average time learning model, so the total time required, estimated total time required to manufacture the first two cars will be 80% of the total time that is required to produce the two cars. If there is no learning that has been taken place. Let's say, it is said that in order to produce the first car, it is 10 hours is required. So if there is no learning at all, the total time required to produce the two cars will be 10 plus 10, 20 hours will be required. But we know that there is 80% learning in place. So if there is 80% learning, the average time required to produce the two cars will be less than the set 20 hours because there is 80% learning. Hence, the time required to produce the two cars with an 80% learning curve will be 80% of 20, that is 16 hours. Right. This is what is the main application of learning curve. We know that with 80% learning, the time required to produce the two cars will be 80% of 20, that will be 16 hours, and the average time required to produce this one car will be 16 by the number of cars 2, 16 by 2, it will be 8 hours required to produce one car. The average time, cumulative average time required to produce one car will be 8 hours when there is 80% learning curve. So here we are given an equation. We could use this example. You could see the estimated total time required for units 1 and 2 will be 10 into 2 into 0.8 raised to 1. So this is actually in the form of an equation where we could let me just shift to a Word document. I will show to you. So in the example, it is said that the time required to produce the first car we said that the time required to produce the first car is 10 hours. And if there is no learning at all, the time required to produce two cars will be 10 plus 10, that will be 20 hours. But it is said that there is 80% learning curve in existence. So the total time required to produce the two cars will be 80% of 20 hours, that will be 16 hours in total. And the average time required to produce one car will be 16 divided by 2, that will be 8 hours. Here we could use an ex based on this cumulative time learning model, we could estimate the time total time required to produce the car produce an item, as well as the average time that is required to produce an item. So in order to find the total time required to produce an item, we could use the formula total time is equal to we could use the total time is equal to time required to produce the first unit. Let us take it as A plus 2 into learning curve percentage raised to N. Here A will be the time required to produce the first unit. Time required to produce first unit. And LC will be the learning curve percentage. N will be the number of doubles. In the cumulative time learning model, cumulative not cumulative time learning model, it is said that when the cumulative number of units doubles, the cumulative average time required per unit declines at a constant rate. So this N represents the number of doublings. Say the first unit will be 1 and the next doubling will be 2, next will be 4, next will be 8. 1 doubles into 2, 2 doubles into 4, 4 doubles into 8. So the first unit represents itself, we know that the time required will be 10 units, 10 hours. For the second